Hello. How are you? I hope you're doing well. Especially if you are going through any challenging times at the moment, and most especially, given the nature of this video, if you are trying to give up alcohol yourself, whether you are a moderate drinker, like I was, or if you are dealing with the more serious side of things in terms of alcoholism. And if that's the case, and no matter what it is you're dealing with, I wish you nothing but the best in overcoming your battles and your struggles and trying to reach a healthier lifestyle, more peace of mind. Welcome to another Let's Talk. This is a little series of mine where I break away from the theatrics and the creative side of what I do here on the channel and use this medium to talk about a wide variety of issues that a lot of us deal with, give you my perspective, share my life experience, and try to be objective as much as possible and talk about different angles and aspects of each little topic. So when it comes to this particular video, Going Alcohol Free, I think is what the title might be. As some of you may or may not know, I gave up alcohol back in November of 2017. So this marks the 1 year anniversary of going, what I'm hoping will be, alcohol free the rest of my life, however long or short that might be. Now this isn't a cause for celebration. That's not why I'm doing this video. I'm a moderate drinker, so it was easy for me, to give up drinking, to give up smoking cigarettes. I know a lot of people have it much more difficult, and I'm not here to flaunt or brag or throw this fact that I, gave up drinking in anybody's face. But because I used to drink and I gave it up, I thought it would make for a good topic to discuss a wide variety of things in relation to mental health, anxiety, depression, anger, addiction, one's health in terms of the weight, and saving money. So I'm going to start with some of the more, I guess, obvious topics in regards to going alcohol free, the addiction, the cravings, things like that, and then I'll get into some other different topics, some of the more outliers, I guess you might say, that maybe we don't often think about. I have with me a whiteboard, and I'll be writing each little topic that I'm going to discuss, just to break things up a little bit. So I guess we'll call this video, Going Alcohol Free. So let me just write Going Alcohol Free. And I guess the first topic, just to give you some background as to where I'm coming from. And give you some insight and perspective. My history. So, I started drinking back in the mid-80s. When I was, I think, around 17. Now, back then, of course, we didn't have the internet, and we weren't very health conscious as we were today. We didn't have a lot of knowledge, of course. I mean, that just happens from decade to decade. You know, you gain more knowledge about things and whatnot. So, you know, and you know, everybody drank. It didn't seem to be a big deal. You know, my father drank, was never an alcoholic, and he actually gave up drinking for the rest of his life, somewhere in his 40s, I think, maybe 30s. I forget exactly. I'll get into a little bit about that in terms of like being a role model and how I'm trying to be a role model for our son in that aspect. But there just wasn't a lot of, you know, education about alcohol. The only thing I clearly remember was in one class in high school, they said that alcohol kills brain cells. So we just didn't really understand we still today don't understand the full effects of alcohol. You know, but I'll get into a little bit about that. So I, you know, like almost anyone, or a lot of folks, I went to my friend's house, and I think the first time I actually ever had a drink was, you know, his parents had some liquor, vodka. I never got into beer. I couldn't stand the smell of beer or the taste. So we would hit the vodka, and we'd mix it with something. I don't remember. So that was the first time I remember, and it was a couple times we would drink at his place. And then after that, you know, I grew up and never really purchased a lot of alcohol where I lived. You know, didn't constantly have a bottle or six packs or a case. My drinking became more of a casual social aspect. You know, I had different kinds of jobs. You know, we would go out, you know, drinking after work occasionally, you know, not every night, not every week, maybe not every month. And, you know, go to the bar, and I would smoke cigarettes and, you know, and have a drink. Most of, in my 20s, most of my drinking was at holiday parties that we would have at work. And honestly, most of my 20s, I really didn't drink much. I smoked cigarettes, I think. I smoked marijuana occasionally. And then there was one point in my mid-20s when I was at a holiday party, and I started drinking before I even started to eat anything, and I got severely ill. And that was pretty much the last time that I had hard liquor for a while. And then I hit my 30s and, you know, started to drink beer for the first time. I think I started with Coors Light, that stuff. And we'd go out to the bar and I'd smoke and, you know, we would drink. And again, it was that kind of casual, you know, just the co-workers hanging out kind of thing. And then I moved away from the Coors Light, started drinking Guinness. And then some point in my late 30s, early 40s, I started taking interest in the craft beer. And, you know, I started to enjoy, I moved away from drinking to get drunk. That was all the way up through my early 30s. And when my wife and I were planning to have our son, I went completely sober. Stopped smoking cigarettes. Stopped smoking marijuana. Again, it was two or three times I think I smoked marijuana in my 30s. And stopped drinking alcohol. But although I really wasn't drinking that much alcohol. More of the cigarettes than anything. So I went, you know, completely sober. The mid-2000s, I was sober for a few years, I think. So this going alcohol-free for me isn't really anything new. But as far as giving up alcohol for the rest of my life, that's the new aspect of this. You know, we got through raising our son in the first few years or so, and I started to pick up drinking craft brews occasionally. And then I'm, you know, once a month, you know, something like that. Occasionally I would buy a six pack, keep it in the fridge, you know, go to visit a family member, you know, a holiday, and I would drink then. But it was always just one or two glasses, one or two bottles. And so I started doing the beer tastings, the beer reviews on this channel. I thought, you know, why not? A lot of folks enjoy it. And, you know, I was enjoying the taste. Of course, the effects of what alcohol does. But I was at a point, honestly, where I was just enjoying the different flavors of the beers. I really like, or really liked, the Belgian wheat beers. Those were one of my favorites. But then around 2016, 2017, I think what happened, or what I'm about to tell you, kind of started in 2016. And that is when I started to notice I wasn't feeling quite right the next day or the week after drinking. Just my head wasn't feeling right. So I started to take some breaks. You may or may not be familiar, all depends on how long you've been watching. I started to take breaks on the channel here and go, and I think there might have been a time when I said, you know, I'm either, you know, giving up alcohol for a while, or I've given up, you know, in between the different beer reviews. And then come November 26th of 2017, just about a year ago, that was the last beer video that I did. And I just came to, about a week after that or so, I just was like, you know what? I think that's the last one. I don't want to drink anymore. It's not doing anything for me. I'm not getting anything out of it. It's like a waste of time. It almost doesn't make any sense anymore. And I'm very fortunate or very lucky that I have whatever it is in my brain, the checks and balances, a gatekeeper, however you want to call it, that I'm able to exercise that willpower and actually give up these things that I think are bad for us, even moderately. I mean, I'm a moderate drinker. I mean, I was a moderate drinker. And I'm still saying that I don't think it's good for us, and I am giving it up. And I'm going to get into a little bit about that as far as the negative aspects of alcohol in society. So that's pretty much my history in a nutshell. A moderate drinker, casual drinker, I've abused alcohol at times, you know, at certain parties or whatever the situation might be, and I've gotten sick. I don't know how many times I've gotten sick, you know, 4 or 5 times, something like that. And I kind of learned that, you know, this is not fun. Again, I just had that something in me was always able to tell me, you know, this is too much. It's kind of like with smoking cigarettes. I could only ever smoke 3, maybe 4 in a day. I could smoke one, I could light up another, but I could just feel myself getting sick. So I'm not sure if you can relate, but I've always had a system that was able to say, hey, Paul, you gotta stop. This isn't making us feel good. Even though I was, you know, the other part of my brain was like, this is awesome, this is great, whatever. So we're gonna move on to some of the different aspects of going alcohol free. And one of the things that I thought it might help with is just write this down here. anger, temper, and irritability. So, as you may or may not know, I did a video about anger and how it can be a good thing. You know, embrace it. It's a part of who we are. You can't really get rid of it. But about a year ago or so, before I did that video, all throughout my life, my short temper, going from 0 to 60, like that, has always been an issue for me. And this dates back even before alcohol. I mean, ever since I was a kid, I was a volatile kid, very rebellious. I mouthed off at my parents, so my anger has always been a mix of good, stick up for myself, stick up for others, and also bad, because, just letting go and letting that temper get the best of me and saying things I regret and all that. And so that's always been a beast of burden for me, not to mention the fact that I deal with hereditary depression, depression that runs in the family, which might actually be the underlying cause for having a short temper and being irritable at times. No one really knows for sure. We don't really know that much about all that. So I thought, back around 2016, I thought I would not just give up alcohol. I mean, the prime reason for me giving up alcohol was, it's just I'm not feeling right. It's not doing anything for me anymore. I want to go ride out the rest of my life with as much of a healthier lifestyle that I can. And one of the other things on my mind was that maybe it'll help with my anger and my temper, but it hasn't. It's the anger, the temper, the irritability, that's just going to be a lifelong battle for me, and maybe you can relate. So I don't think it has anything to do with alcohol. Does alcohol exacerbate it? Does alcohol make the anger and the irritability and the temper worse? I don't really know. I can't say it does, but I can tell you that being alcohol free for a year, I still have to deal with my anger and my temper and being irritable at times. And I think that it might relate more to having depression or hereditary depression that runs in the family than it does with, alcohol. I know we use alcohol a lot as a coping mechanism to deal with anger or to deal with anxiety. Does it make those things we're trying to deal with worse? I can't really say. I want to say no, but I also want to say, it might, especially when you have to deal with the days afterwards and the alcohol still has like an undercurrent throughout your daily life. That's kind of the perspective that I have on it, how I feel that, I have that you drink in the next day, whatever, but even the days after, I've just not felt right. That's what I noticed about me. So moving on to the next topic. Depression. I wish I had a better setup because this is a little awkward. I don't know about you, but like I said, the depression I've dealt with. I've had those days in my 20s and in my 30s, mostly more in my 20s especially in my teens, when I just would. That sleep of depression would just overcome me, and all I wanted to do was just sleep the day away. And I would take like a Benadryl or a cold medicine that always has that, I forget what that over-the-counter drug is that, you know, kind of makes you fall asleep, makes you drowsy. Antihistamine, I guess, is what it is. And I would just sleep the day away, you know, and hope that, you know, escape, try to escape and wake up the next day, you know, trying to feel better. So I had those days. But they are, I can honestly say I kicked depression's ass. And those days are far behind me. And anything now that I'm faced with, I can face with being sober, and I don't need to go to alcohol to escape anymore. I still have anxiety. I still deal with things, you know, in the world, whatever kind of issue it might be. And I get, you know, irritated or angry, and I get my short temper, but I don't need to come home and say, you know, I need to have a drink. But in terms of depression, I can honestly say that when I was doing the beer tastings on the video, that they were not contributing to my depression as much. I felt that I was able to manage my depression and actually overcome it. And I was also able to handle drinking. Now, I had my moments when I used to drink when I was depressed, more so in my early 30s, but not that often. Now, I mean, you know, your mileage, you know, may vary if you are someone that drinks. I would definitely say avoid drinking when you're depressed. I think a lot of folks know that. I think, you know, it's common sense, but yet we still do it. But again, I think there's a lot of willpower that you have to exercise, a lot of, you know, if you're capable of it. I know there are some folks out there who have serious, you know, mental health issues, and they aren't able to exercise their willpower or free will, however you want to say it, and they easily succumb to, you know, alcoholism, I guess you might say, or they've had some very negative and serious life experiences, which could contribute to that as well. You know, the worst thing that ever happened to me was being raised Catholic, some moments of being disciplined by my parents. Fortunately, I was never raised in an abusive household or anything like that. And while I did have some negative encounters with some kids, which did exacerbate my anger for a while, going through my teens and into my 20s, as I said earlier, as of today, here in my late 40s, the waters have grown a lot calmer than they have, especially in terms of depression. But I feel at times that depression hasn't gone completely away, that it's like a beast kept locked in the cellar, as how I like to visualize it. There are certain moments that arise that I can kind of feel the very faint echoes of depression just lingering in the background, but not to the point where I want to drink or I want to just go in my room, shut the door, and go to sleep. It's just that, it's just those old feelings that I once had when a certain situation arises that I have to deal with, that's, you know, a difficulty or a challenge that, you know, I'm personally dealing with, or our family is personally is dealing with for whatever reason. But I feel giving up alcohol, I have more strength, more of a clear head to deal with things and to keep depression at bay. And I don't need meds, and I don't need any kind of man-made substance anymore to cope. I think that's one of the big things. So, all right, let's move on to one of the next topics. I will put down here wish I could do this so you could see it, but it's kind of difficult. Just hold this up here. Go. The craving and the addiction. So, I've never really craved alcohol like I have craved cigarettes. Like alcohol, I started smoking back around when I was 16 or 17. Again, it was just, I was just whatever, you know, smoke to be cool. I see other people smoking. And it's funny how in society, you know, we say it doesn't have an impact on kids or anything like that, but yeah, it does. You know, I was 16, and I saw other people smoking and drinking, and it looks like it's cool. So, you know, I did it. And I'm sure a lot of people can say the same thing. I didn't start smoking when I was 16 because I was depressed or anything like that. We knew about it, and we're like, hey, let's try it. I didn't know how to inhale or anything. And then eventually, I started to smoke a little more seriously and inhaling by the time I was maybe 17 or 18, and we started doing it because it was trying to be cool. And of course, I liked the effect of the cigarette had on your mind as well. But in terms of the craving and the addiction and the effects of the alcohol, there was a point earlier this year in 2018, around May or June, when I felt that feeling like, oh man, I could use a beer. You know, it's summertime, just got out of winter and spring. The nice weather is here. And I don't know if I was out just, you know, on the porch or whatever. It was just a nice day. And I was like, you know, this would be a nice day to have a drink, right? But I said, no, I'm just not going to do it. And anymore, I don't have that feeling. You know, I really wasn't addicted. Maybe a little bit, but not to the point where I was drinking every day. My addiction is sugar and entertainment. And those are the two drugs that I find it most difficult to break free from. Entertainment being video games, movies, you know, anything that can just catch my simple primate brain and wow me and entice me with fancy colors and effects and story and wow, here, take my money. And sugar and dessert and chocolate. It's going to be like a cold day in hell, I think, before I ever give up sugar, or at least when the doctor says, you know, I have to watch my sugar because I may end up being, you know, diabetic, which I think is probably going to happen to me anyway when I hit my 70s or 80s. Knock on wood, if I ever live that far, live that old. So that's the one thing I miss about the alcohol is the taste and the flavor of the, you know, of the craft brews, not, you know, Bud Light or Coors Light. I mean, you drank those to get drunk. You didn't drink those for the flavor. Of course, I do miss a little bit. I don't, like, completely, oh man, I really miss drinking alcohol to get buzzed. I miss it a little bit. You know, I miss that, not the feeling, of course. But as of today, honestly, I can tell you it's not, I don't miss it at all, to where, like, I really need, you know, a beer or anything. In the early part of 2018, when I stopped drinking, there's always that, you know, maybe I'll have a drink, maybe it's not a big deal, maybe I don't really need to give it up, but I'm on a mission to stay sober the rest of my life, at least alcohol and tobacco. I still think about, you know, maybe smoking marijuana again. Should it become legal here in the state of Pennsylvania, and when our son gets older. I haven't really come to terms with smoking marijuana, you know, should it become legal here and having a young son. There's that little moral dilemma, especially with how society, or many people in society, view marijuana as a, you know, a negative drug. You know, it's okay to drink alcohol and coffee, those are drugs. And, you know, a lot of people smoke cigarettes, but there's still this stigma about cannabis is like, you know, just as bad as cocaine or heroin, which I've never done. Marijuana is the hardest drug I've ever done. I've been around a friend that got into cocaine, and I never did that, and I stopped being friends with him. I never did LSD or acid or mushrooms or heroin. Now, I do think about wanting to explore and try a mushroom or, you know, an acid trip. But only if our son gets older, only if it ever were to become legal in some way and I can do it in a safe way. It's not on my bucket list. It's just a thought that I'll get occasionally, you know? But the cravings and the addiction and, you know, missing the feeling of alcohol, don't really have that much anymore. Occasionally, once in a while, if we go to a restaurant and they're serving, you know, alcohol, you know, it's hard to not see, you know, alcohol on the menu. And, you know, I might think, oh, you know, it'd be nice to have a drink again. But honestly, like I said, early in 2018, I'd say maybe the first quarter or two, you know, of 2018, those feelings were a little bit stronger. But today, I don't even have them anymore. Kind of like the same feelings that I have with tobacco. I don't even need it anymore. So, the cravings and the addiction. I was never really addicted to alcohol or to cigarettes either. You know, I was able, again, to, you know, give them up and go for days or weeks without them. My addiction, like I said, is sugar and, you know, entertainment. I'd say, you know, video games, but even those addictions, they're not as bad. I don't stay up till 3 o'clock in the morning anymore, playing video games, like I used to in my 30s and in my 20s. All right, let's move on to another topic. And this will be a more practical topic. That we might not often think about. And that would be giving up alcohol saves you money and might help you pay off your debt. I mean, it's a no-brainer. If you're not, you know, buying drinks when you go out, which, you know, are not inexpensive, and they can run you, you know, a couple drinks can run you almost $20, I guess, depending on where you're at. Or if you're buying a case or a six-pack, you know, and that's money that you can keep in your pocket for something better, or even just to put towards bills if you have credit that you're working on or whatever kind of debt it might be. You know, you can cut back on these different things, not only just to help your physical and mental health, but your financial health as well. I'm a big proponent of that, especially in a society where they're just taking money from you left and right, you know. I don't want to get into too much of a thing, but, you know, you have rent or your mortgage, and then you have your utilities, and then you have a phone, and then you have maybe a car payment, and then you might have a credit card, then you have the cable bill, and so on and so forth, and you're just, your money's, you know, left and right. And whatever, what little bit you have left, you're, you know, buying, you know, whatever it might be. So, you know, one of the aspects, of course, giving up alcohol is having that money, you know, back in your pocket to go towards, you know, maybe getting yourself out of debt. You know, if you're spending $10 to $20 a week on alcohol, I mean, that adds up in the course of a month. And that's $50, maybe $100 a month that you could be putting towards paying off a bill, you know, whatever it might be, or saving for future, or, you know, who knows what. And plus, you're empowering yourself. You know, that's another key to these lives that we live. We're often in debt to so many different people, and we have such little power, often is the case, especially financial, you know. So that's another thing. You're not giving your money away to a company, you know, to an industry that frankly doesn't really care about you or us, right? Like most companies. I mean, there are exceptions. You know, you're treating your body better, and you're treating your wallet better too. So there's that aspect too. All right, let's move on to another topic. Here's another practical or obvious aspect. And that would be your physical health and your weight. And one thing that I noticed, that my weight has leveled off. I've actually lost a few pounds. My diet and exercise has not changed really all that much. I'm not doing any more exercise. I still continue to make sure I walk every day. That's pretty much my exercise. I have a little bit of those lingering effects of depression, and why it hasn't gone completely away is that sometimes it does affect my motivation. Now, I've never been one to exercise a lot. I have, in my 20s and in my youth, I was always riding my bike, you know, as a kid, always outside, all the time. Well, not all the time. I was inside a lot playing video games too. But before the advent of video games, I was outside a lot and always being active. I'm very militant when it comes to making sure, you know, I and our family, you know, gets much needed exercise. But I'm not going to a gym. I'm not working out, doing lifting weights or anything like that. I don't have that kind of a drive. My diet ranges anything from the good stuff, from salad, you know, with tomatoes and chickpeas and a protein like chicken or turkey, from the good to the bad in terms of I still eat at McDonald's, still eat, you know, French fries and pizza and onion rings. You know, so I try my best to maintain a balance between what's good for me and what's bad for me, you know. And like I said, the sugar, the chocolate, it's really hard for me to get away from the junk. But I've noticed with my weight that it has slowly started to decrease, and I've lost a few pounds, and I feel like I've leveled out. And as far as my overall health, I feel, I like to say, clean and clearer mind and body. That's the best way I can describe it. Like, there's no miraculous change or anything like that. It feels good not to have to drink anymore for different reasons. And it feels good not to have any cravings, you know, for cigarettes or alcohol. And I just feel more, I guess, alert, aware, you know, clear-headed, clear-minded. But in terms of my physical health and my weight, that's probably one of the bigger things that I've noticed that's changed. My weight has kind of leveled off. I've lost a few pounds. My lifestyle hasn't changed all that much. So there's that aspect too. If you're looking to, you know, give up drinking, there's, you know, less calories, even though my calorie intake in terms of some of the junk that I eat hasn't changed. So at least there's less calories in terms of the alcohol. So, all right, let's move on to another topic. It's probably one of the reasons that a lot of people drink. Social anxiety, or anxiety in general. I can tell you that one of the reasons that I used to drink was being in social situations, whether it was with, you know, coworkers, hanging out, or I would be at a social gathering, like maybe a party, you know, with other relatives or whatever it might be. An event, you know, and so you'd have the crutch of the beer, you'd get a little inebriated, you know, a little buzzed, and it helps with the anxiety. I would say, you know, in my 30s, in my early 40s, you know, about 7 years ago and going back, that I used alcohol, you know, for that reason. But over the past few years, you know, when I used to drink, having a son, going to different, you know, being forced to go to different social events with other parents, having to go to our son's school, those helped. And of course, along with having different jobs, all those things were contributing factors to my overcoming my social anxiety to the point where I no longer needed to have a beer in my hand to cope with whatever social situation I was in. Now I can go wherever without having that crutch. I can face life sober, head on, and no longer need, you know, an excuse or a crutch of the alcohol to deal with anything. And I no longer need a beer at the end of the day or at after whatever stressful situation I might have been dealing with. I no longer think, all right, well, now it's time to have a beer, which, you know, happens in a lot of cases. You know, you work hard and you come home and you want to just decompress. And what do? You go for the beer. Well, you know, maybe that's causing you more harm than good, even moderately. You know, I mean, I'm a moderate drinker. And I gave up because I started to not, you know, feel well. But in terms of the anxiety, especially social anxiety, I had some major social anxiety. I mean, I was a shy kid growing up, and never would I thought to be doing a YouTube channel. But I used to go to places, kind of have to go for whatever reason might be, and I didn't want to be there, and I would always look for an excuse to get out of it, yeah, whether there was alcohol there or not. And I remember just either getting into an argument or starting an argument just so I could get out of that place. So now you know, I still deal with anxiety. It doesn't really go away. I mean, anxiety, fear, and anger, those are all things that just, you know, bubble up and, you know, to the surface, whatever situation it might be. But now I face everything sober and head on and head strong. And I no longer need to go to alcohol for anything. It's a big learning experience, really. It's like something I want to get into. I guess we'll get into that next. But in terms of social anxiety, you just got to put yourself into those situations. Any situation, really. I mean, that's how you grow. And that's how you, you know, build a character, as they say. But that's how you overcome a lot of your fears. Not all your fears. There are still people that have crippling fears that you just can't get over, no matter how many times you try to face them. I know this from experience, but aside from those crippling fears, there are other things you can do, especially like with job interviews. You know, I used to just sweat and get so much anxiety, get the sweaty palms and just be nervous, you know, going to interviews. But the more you do it and the more you do it, you know, just like anything, the more you gain confidence in yourself. And that's probably another thing, or another aspect as to why I drank, was maybe the lack of confidence in terms of being in a social situation and talking to people I don't know sober. I needed to have a drink, you know? So let's talk about that other aspect, which is in exercise. An exercise in self-control. Or an experiment. I feel like all these things, all these trials and tribulations that we go through, or that we subject ourselves and our bodies to unnecessarily, you know, starting to smoke and taking up alcohol and then not realizing until decades later that it probably wasn't a good idea, and maybe regretting it. You know, maybe someone has serious health issue because of they started smoking when they were young, or drinking. And you just, you know, we don't know, or we don't care, we're young. So I feel like I've done all these things to reach this point in my life now, in my late 40s, to say, I don't need those things, I shouldn't have done those things, to reach a point where I gain more self-control, or I gain more responsibility, and I become sober. And I get through all this emotional volatility that just kind of plagued, you know, the first 20, 30 years of my life, even into my early 40s. And now finally, as I sit here in my late 40s, or getting into my late 40s, the waters are more calm, you know, emotionally. But if I could do it all over again, I definitely wish I never smoked or drank alcohol. The jury is out on smoking marijuana. When I smoked marijuana, I felt I needed it because I was always so self-conscious and kept everything in. But as soon as I smoked marijuana, I would laugh and have a good time, and it's such a stress reliever. But yeah, I feel like I had to go through all this stuff and I'm experimenting, you know, with my body and trying these new things, just so I can reach a point in my life here and say, I should never have done those things. But that's what they say, you live and learn, you know. And fortunately, I'm very lucky that I'm here today, and hopefully, you know, this will help someone out there, who's thinking about smoking or drinking, or maybe someone who's still young who is drinking or smoking, think about, you know, maybe you should give it up. All right. This video is quite long, so we're going to try to end on just a couple more topics here. Next one, a little bit important, is being a role model. So I used to drink around our son, and I know that whatever you do in front of someone that's younger can definitely be an influence. I mean, I know when I was young, and I started smoking and been drinking when I was 16 and 17. But I started to say to our son, you know, don't drink, it's not good for you. But yet here I am, you know, drinking the occasional beer. And that was one of the other aspects of giving up alcohol, is that I wanted to be an even better role model for our son. And say, look, I don't drink anymore, which I've told him. And I tell him, you know, don't ever drink. And he says, I know, Dad, I know. I'm not that old saying, do as I say, not as I do. Well, now I can practice what I preach. I gave up alcohol, and hopefully he won't, you know, start drinking. It would be nice to, if that actually happened, because I really don't think alcohol does anybody any favors. And we'll touch on that in just a moment. But the other role model was my father. I think he stopped drinking somewhere in his 30s or his 40s for the rest of his life. And I think he might have been a little bit heavier a drinker in his 20s, which was, we're talking back in the, 50s, something like that. And you can just imagine how much less knowledgeable, you know, folks were back in the 40s and 50s and about alcohol and its effects and all that. You know, people just, we've been drinking all throughout the history as a means to cope and as a way to, you know, decompress and deal with things. And maybe it's, you know, time that we should probably not do it as much anymore. I don't know. But that's me. I'm not going to tell anybody what they should or should not do, except for our son, and show him, you know, I don't think this is good for you. You look at me, I've given it up for good, you know. So hopefully that will play a key role and be an influence when he, if he ever decides, or if he is anywhere and he's considering drinking. So I think my father giving up alcohol was definite underlying, maybe subconscious factor in me, you know, giving it up too. You know, I didn't want to drink anymore. Wasn't starting to feel well. I no longer really need alcohol, you know, as a crutch. I wanted to be a better role model. And hey, you know, that's right. My dad also gave it up. So, you know, maybe I can do the same thing. So, there's that. All right, we're just going to touch on two more topics here. This next one is going to be about the prevalence of alcohol in society today. Now, since I've given up alcohol, I haven't become one of these people who are anti-alcohol now. I don't really care what people do with their lives. That's their business. I do care in terms of that I hope that they can try to live healthier lives, you know. But at the end of the day, it's everyone's decision, you know, what they do with their life, you know, day to day. And I know there's a lot of folks out there who have these, you know, same thoughts and and they go through these same choices and conflicts and whatnot and decisions. But alcohol is just becoming more and more prevalent, and I don't really know if that's a good thing. I mean, it's in the supermarkets now. It's almost in every restaurant you go to. And I just wonder if it's time in our society today, with how health conscious we're trying to be. Well, what about the effects of alcohol and how prevalent it is? Why aren't we having that discussion? I know it's a very polarizing topic, because you'll have people that don't care, I guess we'll say, and they want to drink, and it's their freedom. And so we can't ban alcohol. I mean, so it's kind of a catch-22. Even if we were to limit the sale of alcohol, and, you know, people are going to start up with the, you know, the distilleries of their own, or the moonshine and all that. So I don't really have an answer. I'm not here to preach or to provide an answer. I just don't think it's a good thing that alcohol is as prevalent in today's society. And I know it's a huge business, and these companies are making a lot of money off of people who may have issues with addiction and alcoholism. And I don't really know. There's a little bit of a moral dilemma there in my mind, as far as making money selling this drug when we're not really doing much to help educate, you know? It seems to be more about the money and the freedom, and I can do what I want and all this. And yet we don't want to practice the responsibility or give some thought as to whether or not we should be drinking as much as we should. And like I said, I'm not here to preach, but that's just, you know, my thoughts. So I guess the one last topic here. I guess a final thought or question. Should we have alcohol in society? It's, of course, you know, not really a simple question to ask or an answer to give. But think about all the negative aspects of alcohol. You have how many deaths related to, you know, people driving under the influence. We have alcoholism, the negative health aspects of becoming addicted. And then you have a lot of the fights that occur, you know, whether it's at a bar or at a sports event. I mean, I've seen a lot of videos of people, sports fans, you know, getting in fights in the stands, someone throwing a beer on someone. You know, it's a little crazy. And of course, the bad decisions that are often made when under the influence of alcohol. So there's a lot of negative aspects of alcohol. And, you know, what are the positive aspects? Well, we could talk about, you know, it creates jobs, but, you know, is that really a good thing? I'm sure we could find another way to create jobs besides, you know, alcohol. I don't want to get into the whole job thing and people's dependency on having jobs and not being empowered to be able to be self-sufficient, but that's a whole other topic for another video. And there's the feeling that you get when you drink. But whatever the positives are for alcohol seem very small, perhaps even insignificant, compared to the negative aspects. You know, the addiction, the alcoholism, the deaths, the accidents, and so on and so forth. So, you know, what do you think? And you don't really have to comment, but it's kind of a rhetorical question. The genie's already out of the bottle. You know, you can't, you know, get rid of alcohol, even if we stop selling it in the supermarkets, which maybe that's what should happen. Maybe the restaurants should be more concerned about not serving alcohol. I can only imagine the riots that might occur. I don't know what the answer is, but maybe we just need to give more thought about alcohol in society, and, you know, should be more discussion and education, especially in the households, you know, and maybe at school. So that's going to do it for this video. Again, I want to wish you nothing but the best as you travel down your own path in life, especially if you're trying to give up alcohol and live a more sober and healthier life. Best of luck to you, and take care for now.